Tonight, we continue our series, The End of AIDS. Yesterday, we looked at San Francisco and at one of the nation's most ambitious plans to curtail AIDS. Tonight, we turn to a city where the struggle is much more difficult. Atlanta, Georgia, and much of the Southeast is, by some measures, the epicenter of America's AIDS crisis. And as correspondent William Brangham and producer Jason Kane report, the barriers to stemming the epidemic there are enormous. This report was supported by the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting.
The alarm bells rarely stop in the inpatient and isolation wards at Grady Memorial Hospital. Here in Atlanta, just down the street from the CDC, in 2016, in the age of life-saving antiretroviral drugs, hundreds of people are still dying every year from AIDS.
The epidemic of HIV in America is forgotten, but not gone. People have forgotten that exists. I think I have a better chance of winning the lottery than I have of ending AIDS in where we are today, right?
The southeastern U.S. is the epicenter of America's epidemic. These states make up 44% of people living with HIV, and they make up half of all new HIV diagnoses.
It's almost like this: the South is a different country. It really is about poverty, you know, social determinants of health, racism. It's really a bunch of different things. It's
Carlos Del Rio is one of Atlanta's leading HIV doctors. He co-directs the Emory Center for AIDS Research and sees patients at Grady. Often, he says, patients have no idea of their HIV status until it's nearly too late.
Half those people we diagnose here already have AIDS. In other words, they've been infected for 5, 6, 10 years.
Russell Martin was one of them. Black gay men are one of the hardest hit populations here in the Southeast. Martin thought he was perfectly healthy until one day he came down with a fever.
I'm just thinking it was a cold. I have asthma, so I'm prone to having pneumonia. So I'm like, okay, maybe it's just pneumonia.
By the time he checked into Grady, he was so sick that doctors induced a near coma in a desperate attempt to save him. He woke up to learn that he had HIV, it had progressed to AIDS, and that he had nearly died. It's not that Martin didn't know about HIV or wasn't being careful. In fact, he once worked at an HIV clinic and got tested regularly.
I got routine checks until I got into a relationship. And it was once I was in a relationship, I didn't do it.
Because you thought, I'm in a monogamous relationship, I don't need to be tested.
Yeah, that's true. That's what I was thinking. I'm not having any problems.
While Martin is currently on treatment and doing well, he's become further evidence for an alarming projection. According to a recent analysis that was done by the CDC here in Atlanta, if current trends persist, half of gay and bisexual black men will be diagnosed with HIV in their lifetime. Half. Fulton County Commissioner Joan Garner has been helping lead the push to change the course of the epidemic here in Atlanta. She started after hearing that few cities in the country have higher rates of HIV.
The information has been out there, research is out there, treatments. Treatment is out there. And I was just floored when I heard that. And I said, we have got to do something about this.
We certainly have some new leadership.
2 years ago, Garner and Council Chair John Eaves assembled the Fulton County Task Force on HIV/AIDS. Fulton County makes up the bulk of the city of Atlanta.
This really shouldn't be a conversation anymore. This is low-hanging fruit. We swing the gate literally from one end to the other.
Like San Francisco, which we reported on earlier, they are one of the first local governments in the U.S. to formalize a plan for ending AIDS. The exact budget and timeline of their work is yet to be determined.
There are a lot of people who are working on this, not necessarily working together.
Dr. Melanie Thompson is helping lead the task force. She says it's unbelievable to her that it's taken this long to get started.
It's horrifying. I mean, frankly, we have had a smoldering epidemic here for a long time. But when you get a little bit of political will, it goes a long way. And that is something that we have never had here.
But the challenges are daunting, something the task force has been hearing about as they've traveled across the county, meeting with various groups, from gay, bisexual, and transgender organizations to those who inject drugs. It's estimated there are 3,000 HIV-positive people in the county who don't know they're infected, meaning they could unknowingly be spreading the virus to others.
At a time when San Francisco is talking about getting to zero and New York is talking about ending the epidemic, we still see increasing numbers of new HIV diagnoses in some of our population.
For those who do know their status and want to start treatment, just getting there can be arduous. Claude Bowen's difficult commute to the doctor is not uncommon in this sprawling city. He has no car and has to travel 2 hours to his appointments.
I take one bus to the train to another bus. If I come down here, I take a bus, the train, then another train, then a bus.
And that's just one way?
That's one way.
If a bus or train is late, he'll miss the next leg, and often his appointment will be canceled entirely. For these reasons and many others, an estimated 40 to 50% of people in Fulton County drop out of HIV care once they've started. For others, even basic information about treatment can be a struggle.
I'm going for like this bohemian type thing.
When 22-year-old Derek Langford was diagnosed with HIV, he had no trouble opening up to friends and family.
I like this.
Sure, the sweater.
But he couldn't figure out what to do next or where to go for medication or follow-up care.
So it was pretty much me searching, looking, using Google a lot to find out where I needed to go. And the stress kind of made me very, very sick.
It's often these kinds of barriers, not riskier behaviors, that drive these high rates of infection. In fact, gay black men don't engage in higher risk behaviors compared to, say, white gay men. Repeated studies have proven that. They often have fewer partners and use condoms more, says Wendy Armstrong. She's medical director of the Ponce de Leon Center, Grady Hospital's massive outpatient clinic for Atlanta's HIV-positive community.
So there's so much easy blame. Those people shouldn't be doing those things, and that is not the situation at all. It is that it is such a prevalent disease in our population for a group of patients who don't have easy access to care.
People living with HIV should be at all levels of engagement.
Daniel Driffin is a member of the task force. He's HIV positive himself, and he says the Achilles heel of the fight against HIV in the South is stigma. He says even he feels it.
I thought I did something wrong, being that I'm now HIV positive, on top of being black, on top of being gay, and in the South.
So this is the South. Bible Belt. And so when it comes to HIV, it's like we are doing something that's immoral to what we've been taught as children.
While stigma about being gay has always been a problem in much of the U.S., Driffin says it's particularly an issue in the black community. And he says it's complicit in the rising rates of HIV infection.
We see what happens when people do tell that they're gay. We see what happens when people do say that they're HIV positive. They're homeless the next morning or the same day. You know, they're being assaulted.
A local man could face federal hate crime charges.
He points to a recent case where a man walked into his girlfriend's house, discovered her son in bed with another man, and threw boiling water onto them.
He boiled a pot of water on the stove, took the pot of water, and poured it all over them. And literally, they were in the hospital for 4 months.
Melanie Thompson says while all these impediments are finally being acknowledged and talked about openly, the region still has major hurdles to overcome them. One example among many, funding. Georgia was one of the states that didn't expand Medicaid under the Affordable Care Act, so it's got much less money to care for its poor HIV-positive patients.
Many of my friends ask me, you know, why are you working in Atlanta? Why don't you go work in Africa or Asia or whatever? Everybody works internationally, and I feel like we have a third world epidemic in some ways here that's difficult to address.
3 years after nearly dying of AIDS, Russell Martin is a testament to the power of successful HIV treatment and to what many hope Atlanta will do more of. He's now studying law and looking towards graduation. The virus is fully suppressed in his blood. He's trying daily to get healthier still. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm William Brangham in Atlanta, Georgia.
Tomorrow night, our reporting continues with a look at New York, the state with more HIV-positive people than any other in the U.S. You can follow our series online as well. Here's what you'll find there.
On the NewsHour's website, you'll find more reporting from our series on HIV/AIDS. There, you can see stories from people we met around the world. You can read more about the effort to find a cure and see all the video reports broadcast on the air. The End of AIDS at pbs.org/newshour.